At Westrack Belize City, we are looking to help you save both your time and money. We've also improved our stock levels to ensure we have everything you might need for your automotive or agricultural needs. Additionally, Westrack has added heavy-duty and industrial parts to keep your trucks and equipment running. At Westrack Belize City, we understand that your time is important, so we want to bring our services to you at your convenience. Now you can simply send us a message on WhatsApp or Facebook, and we will be right there to help with any questions you may have.
One of the leading companies in the production of breakfast cereals. Look for their products in stores near you. Golden Food Products, distributed in Belize exclusively by Racinas Imports.
I choose Happy Cow Cheese because of its perfect portion sizes and I can travel with it.
Because it's nice and soft and creamy and it goes smooth on your bread.
I choose Happy Cow Cheese because I eat it with my beans. I eat it with my fried jerk. And you know why? Because it's nice.
Most of all, when you're on a plane, you know they only give you some crackers and you could just take one out and enjoy it with Happy Cow Cheese.
I'm Miss Baker and I choose Happy Cow Cheese because it goes well with all the stuff I bake.
Happy Cow Cheese. Look for it in a store near you. Distributed in Belize exclusively by Emilio Ahmad and Sons Limited.
Here at Coop Sheet Metal, we believe our job is very essential in serving our customers. And that is just one reason why visiting us is an experience to be remembered.
Here at Coop Sheet Metal, we have a reliable fleet of trucks. We specialize in countrywide delivery of all our material.
Coop Sheet Metal is a family business that was started by my grandfather, who even had many of his machines hand-built decades ago to make our products the most reliable in Belize. Come, visit us at our new facility on Iguana Creek Road, just past the Belize River, leading to Spanish Lookout.
New Buildings Limited is the company of choice when it comes to design, fabricating, and erection of wide-span metal buildings in Belize. At New Buildings, we have a team of well-trained professionals that can produce the most innovative and durable metal structures. Be it domestic or industrial buildings, we can get it done for you. We have put together some of the most outstanding metal structures in the country. We also do estimates and consulting. Visit New Buildings in Spanish Lookout or give them a call at 631-8723 or 610-5185. New Buildings Limited, the experts when it comes to metal structures in Belize.
P-TECH has been in Belize now for more than 6 years. We specialize in residential and industrial high-quality glass windows and doors.
I chose P-TECH windows because they're the highest quality I can get.
I chose P-TECH windows because I'm quite impressed about the way they're manufactured. These are double-pane glasses. They're called low-E. That keeps out a lot of the heat.
Check us out at p-tech.com or give us a call at 671-3842.
Have you treated your pets to the love they deserve? At Reimer's Pet Care, your pets will feel the love with services that include bathing, grooming, clipping, and much more. Come on out. We are conveniently located adjacent to Smart Smile Dental Clinic in San Ignacio and enjoy great discount coupons and refreshments. Reimer's Feed Mill, we're growing Belize.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Matters. Our guest this morning is the Executive Director at Caribbean Community Climate Change Center, the Chief Executive Officer at the Ministry of Energy, Science, Technology, and Public Utilities. Dr. Young, good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Rhonda. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for taking the time to sit with us this morning and have this conversation. For the ones just tuning in, Dr. Young will be sharing his life's journey with us. When you see him today, you see him as a doctor. But if you were growing up in the River Valley in the time that we were growing up in the River Valley, he was, and I use the term very loosely, just an ordinary boy living his ordinary life, going about his everyday business.
He had to have done something different than many that caused him to sit today in the position that he sits. Dr. Young, we're going to start with where you grew up and how, what was that like for you, your home life?
Thank you, Rhonda. I grew up in the village of Bermuda Landing, which, as you rightly said, is in the heart of the River Valley, not too far from where you grew up, just a few miles down the road. And, you know, it's back in those days. I was born in the late 1970s. And so village life was in some ways very different than what it is now. You know, it was, as far as we are concerned, it was the kind of place where there was a whole community that was behind raising children, right? We played, we did all kinds of fun things in the rivers, in the bushes, with very little concern. Of course, back in those days, we would not have had running water, we would not have had electricity, and certainly we wouldn't have had some of the modern amenities of today. But certainly, my childhood memories are very, very pleasant growing up in the River Valley.
It had to be. Tell us a little bit about your family structure. What did your mother do for a living and what did your father do for a living? Did you have siblings or do you have siblings? And if so, where do you fall in that line?
I am the eldest of six children, three boys, three girls. And my father, when I was very young, was a teacher. He taught in the primary school level. And my mom was a supporting housewife for most of those years. Later on, my dad would work in the logging industry. And then, of course, most people would know him as the Baboon Man when he became involved in the community Baboon Sanctuary as one of the founders of that protected area. And my mom was very instrumental in helping provide support during the starting up of that sanctuary. And perhaps when you ask me later on, that would be kind of, that sanctuary would be very instrumental for my career path down the road.
You know, that's exactly where I was going to go, but we're going to take a little time before we get to that. You went to elementary school where?
Bermuda Landing, St. Isabella Roman Catholic School.
And then
that's in Bermuda Landing. Yes. Right, it's right. Essentially, as we say in the River Valley, you know, one sand fly popalik away from my house. Right, it's just essentially right across the road.
Then you had to go to high school. That had to have been a transition for you, because if anybody know life back then, I mean, probably it's kind of still similar now. When you have to wake up early, take the bus. What was that like for you?
That was an amazing transition that I was not prepared for. In fact, my parents kept me back one additional year in primary school because they thought I was too young to start high school in Belize City. I went to SJC, St. John's College. And as you rightly said, Rhonda, back in those days, we didn't have buses, we had trucks. And you know, the trucks would some days be carrying cows in the back that they were taking down to Belize City. And we were sitting on those wooden benches that go across, you know, those trucks. And you're lucky if you got, especially in the rainy season, if you weren't stuck a few times on the way to Belize City. But I had to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning so that I could get ready for school. You know, back in those old days, it's the old iron that you had to do on the fire heart. My mom would help doing that from the night before. But I would be out by the roadside at about 4:45 a.m. to take the truck to Belize City. So for all my time in Belize at the SJC, when I commuted, I was the first student at SJC for my entire time there, because I would usually be there by around 5:30 in the morning.
And I laugh, right? I laugh because I think this generation, they have no idea of the challenges that presented themselves back in those days. I'm glad that you decided to share your story, because when people see you today, they say, oh, Dr. Colin Hafihim bread butter. They don't recognize that sometimes you had to make the bread and the butter all at the same time to be able to eat that day. and your mother being a housewife, taking care of six children, and your father, I mean, it's a single income household. So it's not like you grew up with no gold spoon in your mouth. That is the picture I want people to recognize. If you are eating with a gold spoon now, it is because you created that gold spoon for yourself. But yeah, when you got to school, you had to have been tired on many days. You had to have been sleepy on many days, because no 14-year-old child is designed for that kind of hardship, if you will. While it was not only you, it was a small set of students that went to high school then and excelled. And you were one of those students with all the hardship that you were facing. So I want to talk a little bit about that, especially for students now who say, oh my, they have it hard because they don't have no internet today. Could you imagine?
Yeah, well, thanks for allowing me to share some of this, Rhonda. As I said, we didn't have electricity and we certainly didn't have running water. And so I had to study using the oil lamps. At night, I would get home sometimes in the rainy season when the trucks were stuck. We'd have to take off my shoes. I used to carry a plastic bag in my school bag so I can take off my tennis shoes and put it in my backpack and sometimes walk in mud and water to get home. That's in the rainy season, because Muzzle Creek Bridge, for those of our listeners who know getting to the River Valley, that used to be a little wooden bridge that was essentially just a little higher than the water. And so sometimes I would get home late, 8, 9 o'clock at night, have to get up at 4:30 and come back to Belize City. Very, very tired a lot of times. In fact, a couple of times I ended up in San Hill and once in Mascal because I slept on the Mascal bus. And I remember being in a couple of classes with Father Snyder, who was taught religion at SJC. And a couple of times he would make me stand up in class because I was sleeping all the time. It's like, boy, don't you ever sleep at home? You know, and he would make me stand up and I would hold on to the back of the chair and I would still fall asleep. you know, and so those were the days. And absolutely, while my parents tried the very best to provide for us, I had two other sisters who went to Palote as well. And that meant that on some days, my parents didn't have enough money to provide us with lunch money. You know, as I tell people, SJC is a place where a lot of very wealthy kids go to school. And I certainly wasn't in that group. In fact, many a days I had to pick up bottles, you know, soft drink bottles to sell to my friend Dario, who owned the cafeteria on campus. And that is how I would buy my lunch on many of these, is by going to people and saying, you know what, when you finish with your bottle, you know, can I get that? And that 25 cents, I would buy my gachos, my wheat pies. And sometimes I made enough money from the bottle that I could also help my sisters out, right? in terms of buying lunch money. So we did certainly struggle to be able to travel 26 miles every day from Belize City, and then dealing with the issue of having money every day. And my parents tried their absolute best to provide.
What kept you focused and not bothered about peer pressure? Because, you know, you're coming from the village, you have so much stress on your shoulder, if you will. Maybe you didn't recognize it as stress then, but as we sit here, we recognize that that was a stressful time. And then you are amongst most of these kids that their parents are driving cars, they get to eat, they have $5, which is a lot of money then, okay? Just in case another one, that $5 is a lot. $5 was, you never see $5 as your lunch money for probably a whole 4 years of high school. I mean, right. And I can tell you, because $5 was a lot of money even for all of us. Yeah. What did that do for your self-esteem, if anything?
Well, I was always, from a very young, I always wanted to excel in everything that I did. And that always drove my outlook in life. And, you know, when I went to SJC, there was this sort of mentality that, you know, we are from the bush, we're a little bit backwards, you know, that kind of thing. Even though I was not by any means the first landing boy that went to SJC, my dad actually went to school there, but every generation is different. And so there was this idea that, that we come from the village, they asked me, you know, how many students were in my class in standard six? And I said, six of us, you know, and they're like, six in the whole standard six, you know, and that kind of thing. And so deep down there was this drive for me to show these Belize City kids, you know, that good things come from the village as well. And really that pushed me. And so I was very, very competitive during SJC. I wanted to excel, I wanted to do well. While I was valedictorian, I graduated as the valedictorian from primary school. When I attended SJC, I recognized, and the teachers quickly recognized, that in maths, I was 2 years behind, because the math that they were teaching in the village was essentially 2 years behind what Belize City kids in standard six would be getting. And so I really had to you know, find people who would be willing to help me, to tutor me. We couldn't afford to pay a tutor. And so people were very kind to help to bring me up to speed and catch up. But it's that determination to succeed. And in some ways, it's still something that drives me, is to succeed when people expect you to fail.
What made you, well, I'm sure this will go now to the baboon story, but what made you choose the line of studies that you did?
Well, as I said earlier, my father was instrumental in establishing the Community Baboon Sanctuary in 1985. And I was a daddy's boy back then. I went everywhere with my dad. You know, there's some photographs of him carrying me on his shoulder while taking tourists into seeing the monkeys. And I got very interested in sort of the environment and learned a lot about the howler monkeys that we call baboons. And my dad was just such an excellent storyteller about all things environment. And so when I was 7 years old, he allowed me to take my very first tour with a family of five from Michigan. And I could tell that when he was telling them that Colin will take them into the bush to see monkeys, they kind of looked around for Colin, looked down and saw Colin, and you could see this surprise on their face. They were like, this kid is going to get us lost. He's not going to be able to come back. But I took them, and they had a fantastic time. And that started my career as a tour guide. When I was 7 years old, I would work there on the weekends and on the summertime. And that would shape my lifelong career path, where I became very interested between how people interact with the environment and how important the environment is for people. So later on, when I left SJC and I went to UCB, that's another institution from our era, Rhonda, the the University College of Belize. I would then actually start an associate's degree program in natural resources management. And then later on, I would stay in the same track. So I experimented with a couple of things. Like at one point, I wanted to be an archaeologist because I was fascinated with the ruins. And I wanted to be a marine biologist at one point. I learned to scuba dive early in the 1990s. And I got really seasick one day, and that did it for that. but really, it started because of my engagement with tourists. And each time they asked a question for which I didn't know the answer, then I had this habit of ensuring that by the time somebody else asked me that question, I would now know the answer. So I read a lot, went into the guidebooks and the natural history books to get the answer. And that is really how I got into sort of asking questions and finding the answers.
Did any of this change your personality? Because when I looked at you, or when I look at you now, I see that you are, while you look shy, you are not as shy as you once in my mind were. Maybe I just imagined you as a shy person. But now you can't afford to be shy. You have to be outspoken. I mean, I would imagine all of these experiences created that for you. But did you had to work on it, or it was something that just came naturally because of where you were placed?
I there was a point, I think the tour guiding really helped a lot for the getting rid of the shyness, because I had to be standing in front of people talking about the monkeys and about how the sanctuary was formed and that kind of thing. I always had this issue of the pressure of coming from, you know, what we would, most people would refer to as a very humble, poor family, and not having nearly as much of the material things. You know, I tell people who are close to me that I had one shoes, you know, to go to SJC. I would probably have was three uniform shirts and two pants. And so my mom had to always be constantly washing one. You know, and that sort of provided a little bit of shyness on that front, because you know how kids are. We're very inconsiderate sometimes with others. And so because of that, for a while I was in my little cocoon because of that aspect. But I don't believe I was always shy. In fact, I remember when there was a nun who was around that area at the time, Sister Josella from Palote. I think you know her.
I think we all know her, yes.
I really didn't like her, right? She was, I really didn't like her. And she was strict, you know, but I remember when I had to do my valedictorian speech for primary school, I remember there was this crucifix at the very end of the room. And I memorized my speech, and the entire time I never took my eyes off the crucifix at the top of the church, because I was worried that if I looked at anybody, I would become a little bit kind of stage frightened, right? So, but Sister Gisela was there. She made me do it over and over and over and over again until I remembered. So, in my job now, obviously, and of course, I would later become a professor and taught, and then once I got into the public service, you know, these are jobs that require engagement with people. So in many ways, I am very thankful for my early experiences in engaging and talking with people, because that made me a lot more confident in terms of meeting new people and imparting knowledge, and realizing that there's always room for improvement and that there's so much to learn.
Based on your story, it would appear that you almost followed in your father's footsteps. You taught, he taught. You were very interested in, you are still very interested in the environment. He was interested in the environment on a different level. If you were to say, out of both of your parents, which one had the most influence over your life, who would it be?
That's a very interesting question. I've never been asked that before, but if you allow me, I will answer it this way. I think in the beginning, certainly my dad. You know, I was, as I said, a daddy's boy. He would take me hunting with him. I would be sleeping in the canoe when he's hunting and striking, as they call it, at night. And then when I started high school, is when my relationship with my dad really started to change. And for a number of reasons. One, my dad was smart. He a lot smarter than I am, I think, especially in math. And you know, Rhonda, you have this thing where I would say, you know, daddy, how you do this? And he would take the paper and he says, boy, this easy, you know, bop, 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 and he finish. And I'm looking there like, but I don't understand, you know, and then he box in your head, you know, buy your head hard, you know, and that kind of thing. And after a while, I was like, this doesn't make any sense. Why would I want to be getting boxing on my head every time? So I started with my mom, and my poor mom would be there, and we would be, she had the patience, you know. If it took us 4 hours, she would sit with me and we'll try to figure this thing out, when my dad could do it in a minute. And then also during that time, my father had some problems with substance abuse, right? He was on both alcohol and other drugs. And then that really created some domestic violence situations at home. with the family and my mom, and I witnessed all of that. And so I really became very, very close to my mom. And I think we were each other supported each other quite strongly. And I would say, looking back at my life now, in more ways than one, my mom has been my role model, has been my inspiration, because she's had to deal with a lot of stuff. And somehow she managed to still ensure that all of the kids went to school, and that she provided as best as she can. And that spirit, you know, of sort of being knocked down so many times, and not giving up. And I remember growing up, I was like, why don't you leave? Why are we staying? You know, and she stuck it through. Now eventually the stuff with my dad would improve, right? He would get out of that rut, and he would have had less of a problem with substance abuse. And it never completely disappeared, but he got a lot better. And then I would leave, I would finish high school. I got a scholarship from the US and left UCB and traveled to the States. And so I was there for over almost 10 years finishing school. And it was very difficult to have to be worried about some of the issues happening at home with my family. And my dad, and back in those days, you know, you didn't have WhatsApp. We had one community phone at my grandfather. We'd have to call, and then my cousin would have to run and get my mom and come to the phone. And, you know, we could talk for a little bit. They were like $2 a minute to call and that kind of thing. So eventually, as I said, my dad and I would rekindle our bond. And that was couple of years before he would pass away from lung cancer. You know, so that has, in so many ways, that experience of dealing with my dad and his issues, and trying to focus at school and trying to provide the support for my sisters, my brother and my mom. But unquestionably, I think while my dad's imprint on my life is unmistakable, my mother has been absolutely the most impactful in my life.
How has that experience impacted the choices you make in your life as a father, as a husband, as we see you now?
Well, I was destined to not repeat the sort of the mistakes of my dad. It's one of those things. In fact, I never drank alcohol until I was 21. I've still not yet had even a cigarette. I've never smoked a cigarette, nor have I tried marijuana. Not that I have any issues with those drugs on a personal level, but I was worried that if I tried, I might like it like my dad did. and so I stayed away from it. And my mom used to always say, you know, son, don't be like your dad when it comes to those things. And so and then, of course, when it comes to the whole issue of domestic violence, I remember how we were scared. I remember how we were afraid, and what that did to all of us, right? So that has really, in so many ways, sort of reinforced in my own mind that I would never want to participate in contributing to that kind of fear. Now, as I said, just for the viewers, you know, that was a period of time with my dad, and later on he would, as I said, got a lot better. Resembling the person that I knew and loved growing up as a kid. You know, I thought my dad was the best person in the world. And what was interesting is that for most people who ever met my dad, he was the best thing since sliced bread, you know? But at home, we saw both sides of him. And later on, when he got sick, with lung cancer and was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, him and I had some really very powerful father-son you know, discussions and conversations. We traveled across the country and we talked quite a bit. And, you know, he had, fortunately, had this opportunity to make peace with some of the things he used to do. And that also has left quite an imprint in my life. At the end of the day, my father was, you know, despite those years, he was an incredibly bold and a person who contributed, as I said, in so many ways to my life. I know that was a long answer.
I'm glad that you shared it like that, because you allow all of us to recognize the human in him. He's just human, and he had his ups and downs, and you can't praise a man when he's good and then when he is bad, you forget the praise that you gave him, because he's made up of all of those things. And that is, there's a little bit of your father in every human being on this earth. That is just the reality, maybe in varying degree, but that's just how the life is. But for those times that you were away, you probably had some joys, but you had some stress. You had to stay focused. You had to make sure that your bills were paid. And I'm sure that wasn't an easy task. And forgive me for staying here, but I'm staying here because I want for especially young people to recognize that, especially in this time, when they say, oh, I can't, I know, like I said, the biggest thing is we don't have no laptop and we don't have no internet. There are other ways to get to your goal if you are focused, if you are committed to the cause. You stay committed to your cause. What was one of the factors that assisted you in this commitment?
I think first, personally, it was the desire and the determination that I wanted to do better to help my family. That really provided, I think, a constant source of strength and inspiration to push through. I mean, I went to school in Vermont for undergrad, and the first winter I almost died and I thought I would not stay. Right. I was one of two Black people in the entire school, you know, and so dealing with the whole issue of being a Black person in the US was also very interesting and new to me, and not being able to go anywhere close by to say, oh, there's a cousin or there's an aunt or anything that was Belizean. Other than that, I think what provided quite a bit of inspiration was role models. I had, fortunately, Roy Young, who was Dr. Roy Young from Bermuda Land. He's my cousin. He grew up right next door to us. And he was the first person in the River Valley that I was aware of, and certainly in Bermuda Land, and I had a PhD. And I would talk with him, and he would tell me, you know, how he did it and what he did. And interestingly, the story that stuck with me for a long time, it was not the fact that he went to school. He was telling me about the cafeteria at Cornell where he did his PhD. And he says, you know, they have these machines there that that you can get unlimited amount of chocolate milk. And I was like, and I love chocolate milk, right? At the time. So I was, what are you? He says, yeah, you just take your cup and you can, if you want to drink 20 cups, you can drink 20 cups. And so, you know, the idea was in this way, that kind of stuck with me. But Roy having done it, and then I asked him, I said, you know, and so how old were you and how you did it? And so I had this thing in my own head that whatever age Roy did it at, I wanted to do it younger. And so, as I said, I'm competitive, you know, I don't like to lose, but I'm a good loser. If I lose, I recognize that I lose. And so that, fortunately, I always did well in school. And so I was able to secure a scholarship, to go to the US. And then I did very well there in college, graduated at the top of my class. Had my choices of graduate schools to attend, and got a full scholarship to do my PhD, my master's and my PhD. So that happened because I recognized that my parents didn't have the money. I certainly didn't have the money. And once I recognized that doing well in school can provide a gateway to going further, I was determined that I would do well in school. And that's how I did it.
You mentioned mentoring. Besides Roy Young, did you have any other mentors in your life? And if you did you choose them or did they choose you?
I always had my mom. As I said, my mom has been my biggest supporter, my biggest source of inspiration, because when things got rough, and things did get rough quite a few times, I would reflect on what my mom went through and had to endure, and said to myself, you know, this is nothing compared to that. So, you know, get up and do what you've got to do. And so that was always a source of inspiration there. And then surprisingly, I had quite a bit of strangers who would become mentors, and that happened almost with sort of serendipity. We would talk to people, meet people, and I always say that the success in my life, or the successes in my life, most of them had to do because a stranger came into my life at kind of the right time. And these are people who saw something in me that I may not have recognized in myself and decided to give me an opportunity. In fact, the first opportunity came when a group of professors from the US would come down. I guided them for a couple of days, and this is what they told me, they were so impressed with my knowledge of all things environment at the Monkeys. They said, you know, why don't you come to school in the States? And I said, yeah, thank you, but there's no way I can afford that. And they said, well, why don't you meet us at the bar/restaurant in our village that night? And so I went down, and they said, you know, we've talked among ourselves, and we feel that we can find you a scholarship for you to come to Vermont to study. And I said, that's really nice, thank you. But, you know, I thought these were empty promises at the time. And a couple months later, I got a letter saying, you know, that they found me a scholarship. and so that's how I left. And when I was there, there was this guy who was a psychologist. He was one of the professors at the university and who had come to Belize. And he essentially, except for doing the papers, he became a father figure to me. He had a house with multiple floors. I essentially lived on one of the floors. He provided me with a vehicle for my entire time there. He would attend sessions as my parent, you know, in the States. And we would talk about all kinds of things. So Tom was in many ways a father to me when I was in the States, you know, completely unexpected. And he just recognized that this is a role that he was willing to play, and that he did it without any expectation of anything in return. And later on, when I went to do my master's and PhD, I would have a similar mentor. Who was interested and vested in my success. In fact, I had written a recommendation for him to what is called a Mentor of the Year. It was a national award across the entire professoriate of US universities. And this he was Gregory Anderson from the University of Connecticut. He was my advisor and the chair of the Ecology and Evolutionary Biology Department. And I wrote a paper about how instrumental he was in my life as a mentor, and he won the national award, right? Because you know, there's so many things happening in my life, and when I wanted to give up and lose focus, you know, Greg would bring me back and inspire me to continue. And I think what I would like to say to anybody out there who, if my story inspired them even just a little bit, is that that seeking out and reaching out to people is an important part of your journey. And sometimes you might not find what you're looking for, but people will find you. And when you find, when they find you, you know, listen and internalize what is being said, and then pursue your dreams, because these are persons who came into your life for a reason. And that's what has been, I think, in many ways, your success. Now you have to help yourself, obviously. You know, while people helped, you certainly have to have the drive and the passion. And whenever I got tired, as I said, I focus on those dark moments to provide me with the energy to push through.
What so far is your proudest moment?
I think, since it has nothing to do with school, I really think, you know, I was obviously very proud of myself when I graduated with my PhD. I was just about to turn 28 when I finished. And that was, I thought at the time, my proudest moment. To see my mom came to my graduation and I could see her tears falling down her face, and I thought, you know, that was it. I was happy, my whole family, they were happy. But I think my proudest moment was when my dad and I reconnected. When I came back home, you know, people used to always tell me that my father was very proud of me, but he would never say it to me. You know, and strangers would say so. And then when I came back as an adult, because I left in 1997 and came back in 2005, and then he would get cancer a few years later. And the fact that him and I could have sat down and reflect and get over whatever issues we had, you know, that to me was one of my proudest moments, because it meant I could get over the hurt and I could get over why I was so mad at him for so long. And when that happened, I had this feeling of freedom and liberation from some of the guilt. And my dad and I, as I said, became very, very close for the last couple of years of this. So that is what I treasure even today.
What is your greatest wish?
My greatest wish is that I can become a beacon of light in the lives of others, to help them on their journey as people were to me.
I think that you have been. I think that is what you continue to do. For somebody that's watching now that's thinking, you know, as much as the challenge that you faced, you were lucky. This angel came and took you off at each time. And they may feel that they don't have that angel, or they don't have that gift, if you will. What would you say to him or her?
As I said, you have to want this. This is something that you have to set a goal for yourself. And the goal is one step at a time. You know, while you want to say, I want to go and get a PhD, or I want to be an architect, or I want to be a lawyer, you know, there are multiple steps and multiple waypoints on that journey. And the hardest thing is to start and get to the first waypoint. And then once you're at that waypoint, you put your eyes on the next one. And at the end of the day, people remember humility. People remember integrity. They remember attitude in terms of whether they can see that fire in you, that fighting spirit to succeed even in the face of adversity. And when you create that positive energy, despite the challenges in your life, because there'll always be challenges, people start to notice. And that is where your, as you said, your angels might come from. It is are those people who you don't know and who you don't realize are watching you, but who are watching you and perhaps in their mind, they're deciding or trying to decide whether or not to lend a helping hand. And so that's what you have to do. And trust that by giving it your best, that as part of that process, people will see that and help. Because there are good people in this world. There are many, many good people in this world. And sometimes, these people are the people who you least expect to be, to come into your life. So set your eye on a goal, start, give it your absolute best, and treat people with respect, be humble, have the right attitude, and people will come to help.
Dr. Young, thank you for taking the time this morning to share with us. Definitely, I enjoyed this conversation. I am sure that it impacted many lives in a positive way. Is there any final thing that you'd like to leave with us?
I want to thank you, Rhonda. This was certainly not an easy conversation to have, to reflect on your life and to talk about oneself. And when you asked me to do it, I had to think of whether I wanted to or not. And ultimately I decided, and I'm happy I did. So I want to thank you. As I told you, you asked me what one of my wish is, and that is to be a source of inspiration and help others as much as I was helped. And, I have been and want to continue to pay it forward. And so if there's somebody out there who would like to know about a little bit more about how I may help them in terms of being a mentor and share my stories of how I went and navigated through school, I would be happy. I would be happy to talk with them and to serve as a mentor to them. And so certainly they can find me on Facebook. And if they saw this interview and they think that I can help them in any way, even if in a tiny little way, they should reach out.
Dr. Young, again, I say thank you. Have a lovely day.
Thank you, Rhonda.
At Westrack Belize City, we are looking to help you save both your time and money. We've also improved our stock levels to ensure we have everything you might need for your automotive or agricultural needs. Additionally, Westrack has added heavy-duty and industrial parts to keep your trucks and equipment running. At Westrack Belize City, we understand that your time is important, so we want to bring our services to you at your convenience. Now you can simply send us a message on WhatsApp or Facebook, and we will be right there to help with any questions you may have.
One of the leading companies in the production of breakfast cereals. Look for their products in stores near you. Golden Food Products, distributed in Belize exclusively by Racinas Imports.
I choose Happy Cow Cheese because of its perfect portion sizes and I can travel with it.
Because it's nice and soft and creamy and it goes smooth on your bread.
I choose Happy Cow Cheese because I eat it with my beans. I eat it with my fried jerk. And you know why? Because it's nice.
Most of all, when you're on a plane, you know they only give you some crackers and you could just take one out and enjoy it with Happy Cow Cheese.
I'm Miss Baker and I choose Happy Cow Cheese because it goes well with all the stuff I bake.
Happy Cow Cheese. Look for it in a store near you. Distributed in Belize exclusively by Emilio Ahmad & Sons Limited.
Here at Coop Sheet Metal, we believe our job is very essential in serving our customers. And that is just one reason why visiting us is an experience to be remembered.
Here at Coop Sheet Metal, we have a reliable fleet of trucks. We specialize in countrywide delivery of all our material.
To Hoop Sheet Metal is a family business that was started by my grandfather, who even had many of his machines hand-built decades ago to make our products the most reliable in Belize. Come, visit us at our new facility on Iguana Creek Road, just past the Belize River, leading to Spanish Lookout.
New Buildings Limited is the company of choice when it comes to design, fabricating, and erection of wide-span metal buildings in Belize. At New Buildings, we have a team of well-trained professionals that can produce the most innovative and durable metal structures. Be it domestic or industrial buildings, we can get it done for you. We have put together some of the most outstanding metal structures in the country. We also do estimates and consulting. Visit New Buildings in Spanish Lookout or give them a call at 631-8723 or 610-5185. New Buildings Limited, the experts when it comes to metal structures in Belize.
P-TECH has been in Belize now for more than 6 years. We specialize in residential and industrial high-quality glass windows and doors.
I chose P-TECH windows because they're the highest quality I can get.
I chose P-TECH windows because I'm quite impressed about the way they're manufactured. These are double pane glasses. They're called low-E. That keeps out a lot of the heat.
Check us out at p-tech.com or give us a call at 671-3842.
Have you treated your pets to the love they deserve? At Reimer's Pet Care, your pets will feel the love with services that include bathing, grooming, clipping, and much more. Come on out. We are conveniently located adjacent to Smart Smile Dental Clinic in San Ignacio and enjoy great discount coupons and refreshments. Reimer's Feed Mill, we're growing Belize.